Hello everyone, thanks a lot for taking time to join us today on the second episode of Rethink Retail. Today we have with us a very, very special guest and someone I personally look up to for many, many reasons. He has been a very, very senior executive within the Tata Group. He has headed many other businesses beyond Star Bazaar, like the Tata Capital, the Taj Hotels and Resorts, and many others. His total work ex is more than my age. So it's a pleasure to have you here, Jamshed, with us today. Thanks a lot for taking time. Welcome.
Pleasure to be here. Thank you very much, Abhinav.
Cool. So Jamshed, let's get started right away. I have listed a lot of questions. So how we are going to do this is, I have some regular questions around business, leadership, and all the other things for which you are an expert. And we would love to understand the candid thoughts on all of them from you. Then I have a very interesting, you can say, some sort of like quick questions where you would, I mean, just about your likings and things like that to understand you better. And maybe we'll spend around 30-40 minutes on this. Then we'll open up for the last 15 minutes for the audience questions. We have people here on AirMeet as well as on Facebook Live watching us. Cool. So we're good to get started. So Jamshed, right, first thing, how has the COVID time been? I think that's our first April is when you really stepped down from Star Bazaar. So how has the experience been for you? What was going in your mind when you were kind of stepping down and this whole pandemic was kind of at its peak?
Oh, well, actually, I had not planned to time my stepping down with the pandemic. I've been thinking about this for over a year now, because I felt that I had picked up a lot of diverse experience throughout my career. And I just wanted to leverage it differently and look at a different world from the corporate world that I was in. In the corporate world, typically there is a single-minded focus. It's one business, one company, and you go out and get the results. And I wanted to broad-base my thinking. Coincidentally, actually, it helped me. Because I thought I would have enough time to go and then visit people and then build connections. But rather than that, I think people also had enough time to connect with me. And therefore, in fact, I've been more busy than I thought I would be. So what I'm doing actually is a wide variety of things. I'm working closely with small businesses. Either they are startups, or they are family business company, family offices, and helping their businesses scale up and grow. So that's my focus. And also partner in a accelerator firm called 10x2, which looks at tech companies in the startup phase or in the early stage phase and helps them scale up and then, you know, consult with them and then get them funding, etc. So wide spectrum and quite exciting here.
Interesting. And how are the Star Bazaar guys kind of like bearing it? I mean, you've been there for a very long time. So I'm sure they must be reaching out to you for help and guidance. And so how are you kind of managing both?
Actually, we've got a very good person running Star Bazaar right now. He's come from the UK. So there is a lot of continuity because, like I said, I've been planning this for over a year. So it was a kind of smooth transition, which is the way it should be.
Yeah.
And the business model is set. And fortunately, we are in food retail, which is considered essential. And that has helped a lot in keeping the business and momentum going. I think the strategy that we had designed, which is to be closer to the customer, and drive on convenience and drive on fresh, actually played out really well in the COVID time, even more. I mean, it was not planned for such an event, but I think it played out even more, and it's very suited to the current business environment that we find ourselves in. And I think going forward, it will be putting Star Bazaar at an advantage.
Right, right. So what's your overall take on how the new normal for the business is going to be like? What's the role that e-commerce is going to play? What penetration do you think it would really get? I think StarQuick is a fairly evolved platform already. So what's your, say, 5-year plan? I mean, how do you like view it?
So how I would not, well, not only Star, but any food retailer, I would view it in a similar fashion. I think certainly there will be a new way of shopping for people. So that is a given. And that new way of shopping is going to be driven by various plays that have happened in this COVID time. So first, of course, is the movement towards e-commerce. So certainly customers will want to move a lot more online. But what has happened is that during this period of time in COVID, some of their confidence in online has also been shaken when it comes to food. Now, that could be because, you know, deliveries were not happening on time. The fresh was not as fresh as it ought to be for many companies who are not operating a hyper-local food delivery system. To my mind, customers really require reliability of e-commerce. Yeah. See, one is speed and the other is reliability. I think people will live without speed, but not without reliability. So you want, if you have ordered for an item, you don't mind ordering it a bit in advance. And food, the kind of food and grocery is not really impulse. I mean, you know, you plan yeah. your purchase a bit. You want it on time and you want it in the quality that you would get if you went to the store. So that's the big thing about e-commerce. And I think StarQuik does a good job of delivering fresh. And that gives it an advantage. But anyone who delivers fresh well will certainly be at an advantage. The second thing, of course, is that customers will want to shop in a store for very specific reasons. But they want their entire shopping mission to be taken care of by the company. So there has to be a mixture of my ability to order online, pick up from store, order partially online, go to the store, top up my basket, pick it up in one shot. Order offline, go there, but not go to the cash counter, just leave the items there and walk away and have someone ship it to my home, and a combination thereof. So I think, and this is where you, even Purple comes in, I think very handy. Customers are going to look at what I call omni-choice. It's not about channel. It is omni-choice. You give me the choice that I want in terms of how I want to access you. How you deliver through last mile, third party, fourth party is not my concern. So you give me omni-choice. I'm happy if you are on a delivery platform, if you are delivering through a delivery platform, but I want reliability and quality. But I want this interactive choice. So that's how I see it in food retail. I think other retails will shape differently, of course. It's not going to be the same, you know.
Interesting. Yeah, absolutely. And in terms of like how do you view the overall market? If you see e-commerce in India is still very, very small, hardly does $30-35 billion in overall volumes and revenue every year, with grocery under $1 billion. How do you expect these numbers to be, say in 4 years, five years from now?
I think that, I certainly see these numbers growing at a very rapid rate. I think they will grow at three times the rate of physical retail, in my view, in the next couple of years. But the point we have to understand is that it all depends on how well the players play the game. See, very often when we look at industry growth and then there are projections done, the projections tend to reflect demand. But the question is, do you have robust systems or not? So let's say if Reliance Jio really takes off, the ratios can actually change quite dramatically. So a part of the growth is because of the natural behavior of the market, but a part of the growth is how there are evolving models. Now, what has happened is that e-commerce has got a brilliant opportunity to evolve their models rapidly because they don't have, because, you know, the chase for real estate is not there. And how well they evolve. So if you just read in today's paper, Hari's company, that is Big Basket, has hit the 1 billion run rate.
Yeah.
Now the question is, part of it is because of opportunity.
True.
Now, when they continue to hit the 1 billion run rate, how they will evolve their model to keep at it is the core question, according to me. But the window is open. if you are a strong, of course, you are better off being omnichannel than pure e-commerce. And therefore, even in the case of pure e-commerce players like Big Basket, a reverse partnership or relationship with some physical retail players may not be a bad idea. Amazon does it, but then Amazon does everything with everybody. So that's a separate issue. But because their game plan is different. But to evolve its customer, not looking at channel, they are looking at omni choice.
Yeah. So where would you kind of put your money on? Do you see marketplaces like Big Basket, or do you see like other retailers like really scaling up and coexisting in a significant market share?
You know, frankly, the one retail which is of most interest is the play that Reliance has made. I think it's the play is fantastic because it is what they have done over the last many years is built a huge backbone of physical stores. And when I say the backbone, I don't only mean restricted to... See, every store is an outlet and a customer touch point. Now, it may sell apparel, but it can very well be a pickup point for any. If you imagine the ecosystem that Reliance controls, both in terms of the physical stores, in terms of the digital presence, in terms of Jio, and in terms of all the other digital plays that they make, to my mind, there are ways to offer this. Now, it's not easy, mind you, but I'm saying that they're best poised to have this whole offering to customers quite brilliantly. Now, how do you link up different kinds of formats and systems to... Now, if you go to Reliance, for example, there are a zillion apps for Reliance. I mean, you know, every Reliance aspect has an app, you know. How do you integrate all of that and give customers a seamless... It's not easy. But I think there is a beginning to be made, and I think they are the best poised to do that and become a truly seamless retailer in the country, because they've got scale.
True, absolutely, and I think the numbers speak for themselves. So interesting. So Jamshed, maybe I'll take a different direction now. Would love to understand from you. You have been a MD, a head of different businesses, a CEO many times in life, and for businesses which are very different, like right from a hospitality business to a finance capital business to grocery. So what does being a CEO really, really mean for you? How do you go about it? How do you pick up the new markets and industries so fast?
Yeah, so I've been fortunate that I've moved across. So I started with Titan, and then, of course, I went through the journey. See, my whole approach always has been that while business models may change, customers, process, and people are intrinsic to any business model. Okay. And customers, people, process, and partnerships, which is your vendors and your associates. Business, you get into and understand the nuance of customer, people, process, partners, and you need to understand the linkages. So I would spend a lot of time understanding these aspects of any business. Then there is the technical aspect of the business, which, frankly speaking, your teams can deal with. So when I went to hotels, I didn't have to know hoteliering. I needed to understand how guests reacted to our product offering. But that understanding comes if you understand guests or customers. How to run the hotel was not really something which I needed to focus on. Mm. And I think I've kept that as a principle throughout. My part of time is content. Personal leadership style is a front-end loaded leadership style. So I like to spend time in stores or at hotels or in the branches to actually experience the customer, product, service, people interface. And then as a leader, it is important to experience those and then bring them up and connect the dots to come up with more meaningful strategies. And that is the trick. Now, that trick works in any... Now, I've mainly been in B2C businesses where this whole approach works. Now, if it was a B2B business, this approach may not have worked. But certainly in a B2C business. And the whole idea of as a CEO is also to get and look at figures. But you need to get the essence of the business, and you can only get the essence of the business if you are steeped into the business also. And I tend to spend a lot of time getting steeped into the business, you know.
Right, right. But how would you do that, say, when you were heading Tata Capital, right? I mean, there the business, I mean, the consumer end might be a bit hard to get to.
So there, fortunately, I was looking after the consumer part of the business. So it was basically retail loans and retail auto loans and stuff like that. So again, end consumers. And I was there for a very short time. There we had to set up a branch network. What I did. But again, it was in consumers. So I was not in the B2B part of the business, which is a little bit of a different game, actually.
Absolutely. I understand. Got it. So largely what you're saying is customer is the king. That's the basic principle which applies everywhere.
Well, I normally say customer is the queen, because businesses that I've led, it's the queen which has been ruling the business more than the king. But yes, you're right.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's a good analogy. Interesting. Maybe let's digress a bit more into the Tata Group, right? So how has your experience been? What are the different things that they do, right? They're very heavily known in the market for the culture they build, the principles they have. So is it easy to work with them, or does stuff like this kind of become a deterrent when you are trying to run businesses independently?
See, what happens is that when you step into the Tata Group, and I went in as something called a TAS officer. When you step into the Tata Group, you step in knowing fully well that there is one particular way in which we will do business. And that's the best way. We also, as a group, have a lot of compassion and a lot of, we have a softer side. And it is important that you realize as a leader that these are the aspects available of the way that Tata's operate. Now, that's a given. It is then up to you to take it on positively as a challenge or not take it on. But once taken on, we never quote this as a problem or a hindrance. So there's an ethical way of doing business, and we do business the ethical way. And our business models are such that we practice that ethical way in the business model. So we create business models which rely on a very high level. The other side, and on the people-centric culture. So you all know how people-centric Taj is, and you know, we've seen some experiences of that. And we all know that when we are dealing with people in the Tata Group, there is a way of doing so. And it is not a constraint or a restriction. That is us. That is our DNA. You know, you can't, it's like the human being saying, the body saying that my DNA is a problem. Then there is no human body, right?
Yeah.
Similarly, it is our DNA. So it is a DNA we accept. And then we build our strengths on our DNA.
Right.
And that's what the Tata Group is known for, that it builds its strengths on its in a variety of functions. The one thing I have never faced in the Tata Group, fortunately, in any company that I have worked in, is that there is no sense of hierarchy at all. I mean, you know, I could actually be very close, even at a junior level, when I was a junior, could be very close to the leadership and learn from them, provided you're willing to learn. Yeah. I think it's a beautiful culture, and it I've seen that across all the companies that I've worked in. And I've obviously, in the Tata Group, while on the way up, you absorb the culture. When you are in a senior position, you emanate the culture. So, you know, you have to radiate the culture yourself. See forward. That's how we do it.
Right. What are the other core aspects that like the Tata Group really gives you to really take care about? Like, how are things like profitability or long-term growth? How are all of them really looked at?
Yeah, I think in the Tata Group, sustainable growth is certainly looked at with a great deal of importance. And profitability is a very high focus. But profitability on the right. So it's basically a very calibrated, future-looking, sustainable, growth-oriented approach. We don't build businesses to shut them down, obviously.
Yeah.
We build businesses to grow them over years and years and years. And the legacy of the Tata Group is quite evident with the number of companies which have been there for so many years and doing well. And therefore, sustainable growth in a meaningful fashion is a very key to the Tata Group. And as CEOs, we all try to do that to balance the challenge, ability. It's easy to do one and not the other, but it's always a challenge to do both. And that's how it is done. And that is true for many other businesses also. Many other groups are also like this. It's not only the Tata Group. But that's the core of how we manage our business. We are allowed to dream, but your dream must be rooted and anchored in reality.
Right. Wow, that's a pretty interesting and I think an India-specific way of looking at things. So maybe moving on a bit to when you were at Excel, say back in, 1986, right? Did you really expect all of this, that you would go on to like be heading so many different businesses? And if suppose you have to look back, say the last 34 years, right, what are the top 3-4 things that you would go and change or maybe do better?
Okay, that's interesting. When I was in Excel, I always wanted to be in general management. I never had quite imagined it this way, but I always wanted to be in general management. So to that extent, I achieved my objective, and therefore I was with I joined the Tata Administrative Service. I had got other jobs also, but I chose the Tata Administrative Service because I wanted to be in general management. So yes, it certainly panned out that way. And this was by intent and by opportunity. So I got opportunities and there was an intent. I think when I look back at the 34 years, what could I have done better? I'll tell you what I could have done better. See, there is a lot of times I could have become people manager than I was. Now, people think I'm a good people manager and they rate me as a good people manager, but I think I could have been a better people manager. And I wish that some of the maturity which I have now, I had in those days. As a leader in the initial phases of my career, I used to be I used to gel with the people, I used to interact with them. In fact, in Titan, I remember when I was in the factory and in negotiations, I would be negotiating with the union in the room. And in the evening, they would come to me for advice as to how they should negotiate against me the next day in the union. So it used to be like that. But I used to work more on finding out people's shortcomings and helping them overcome them. So my goal was that, thinking that if I find a shortcoming and help them improve, I'm making them a better person. Ideally speaking, I should have been leveraging more on their strengths to make them stronger people. And I think that's a learning which came to me later on in life. And if I had been there earlier, people would have tolerated. So people are more than kind to me. I think they have tolerated me a lot more than I deserved. But I wish it was not the case. And I wish I was much nicer to everybody in my earlier years in the group. So I think that's a big learning as concerned,
Wow, that's quite amazing. And now, when you are, say, out of the Tata Group, like, is it easier or harder or just very different or similar to how it was?
I'm very lucky. I think I have the kind of experience I've gathered makes sense to people, and therefore I'm quite engaged. But I'm discovering a totally new world, which as a CEO I didn't see, and that is the world of entrepreneurship and technology in its truest sense, which is in India. I mean, the kind of stuff people are doing, and it is amazing. So, and as a CEO, I should have paid more attention to what is happening in my environment than I did. And I'm talking about the startup and the early stage company environment. It is amazing. I think the challenge is to take all that and shape it to solve business problems, which is the big challenge. So, you have got solutions and you've got problems. Let's say there is a corporate which needs an integrated approach to a solution and people are running bits of the problem. bits of the solution, and you need a business orientation to bring all that together to take solutions to corporates. And according to me, that's a big eye opener as far as I'm concerned. I think that, and especially with this COVID, I think the digitization of India and Indian companies, not from a government point of view, but from a private point of view, has really is it, to me, it's a given now. I mean, you can't avoid it, you can't escape it. It is in that context that I think it's a totally new world, and that's very exciting for me. And that's why the accelerator company that I work for, 10x2, does exactly that.
Right. And how are you viewing the overall conditions? Like what I'm reading online, like hundreds and thousands of startups are shutting down, small businesses are massively hit. What do you suggest all of them, like the people who are really in the trenches right now?
Yeah, I think it's an unfortunate situation that we are in. That when the economy is going the way it is, the more adventurous and the more reaching beyond yourself, because you are obviously an entrepreneur and you have a problem. My advice to people would be that, look, if you have a very strong idea, you are not able to execute that idea because of the current conditions, don't give up the idea. See, there is a difference between your idea and your execution of the idea. Keep working on the idea. You may not be getting business right now, so you have to cut off all the fat. Keep your muscle, cut off the fat, and keep working and fine-tuning the idea, because things will change. There are certain sectors where things have already changed.
Yeah.
Also, what happens is that given the situation that we are in, there is a lot of opportunity being thrown up, which we didn't know before. So, for example, there are various business cases now emerging where people are looking for tech. Okay, because of COVID, because of social distancing, because of tracking, etc., etc. So, you know, we are working with a company which can do, which through cameras can do 360-degree profiling and tracking of both vehicles and employees.
Oh, wow.
Without any human intervention. Now, you know, if you told me that 2 years ago, look, I've got this technology, you'll say, okay, theek hai, in some space research or some oil refinery, it might be a little useful, you know, because of security.
Yeah.
But today it's become a norm, you know. Say, and everywhere with the employee check through camera privacy, you know. So new solutions will come up. Every crisis brings about a new set of solutions and a new set of opportunities. And you gotta hope that are in that sector, or evolve your business model to be in that sector, so that you can make advantage of that. But anything which has a deep digital root, I want to succeed. If not now, certainly in the near term.
Right, absolutely. And how, as I mean, since we're talking about startups, right? What is your take on the external capital, external funding? Isn't it already a lot of capital that the Indian companies are raising? And in your opinion, why do you think they need to raise so much capital to build companies? Like, because I mean, for example, Google in their complete journey raised like $3.5-4 million in the entire funding that they raised. They built like a multi-billion-dollar company. So why is it different for India? And when do you think it would catch up?
Yeah, I personally feel that I think in the pre-COVID era, people were a bit too enthusiastic to place money. They will get that one big bet. Okay. And I am actually quite surprised as to the amount of, you know, there is a lot of financial due diligence done on a business before people invest money. But I don't think there is enough of business due diligence done on a business before people invest money. And I think that there is a gap. To my mind, I think the people who invest are also come from a finance background. The people who scrutinize the investment come from a finance background. And I personally feel that the chase for the the runways are longer and longer. I mean, you have to keep financing the runway, as it were. And that's the unfortunate part. Frugality has not been the core focus of investment. Yes, if it's a great idea and got a great opportunity, we will invest and hopefully we'll make a killing. That's fine. I think in the short run, depending on how the bubble goes, it's okay. Approach. And, you know, we are going to put money in 10 companies. Even if two succeed, we made the money. We don't mind if eight fail.
Yeah.
I think the time has come for, you know, the focus has to be that many more should succeed, even if it takes longer, by being more sensible about things. And I think you're right that that has not happened in the past, which is why we are seeing a problem. Mm. For companies who have tight business models and who are going very strongly for unit economics and then profitability, it should not be as much of a problem. You know, and these are fundamentals of business. Say, finally, they will catch up with you.
Right. Interesting. Cool. Maybe I'll digress a bit into a new theme altogether, right? I mean, a lot of stuff has been happening from the government side. At least they've been announcing a lot of stuff. So what is the Atmanirbhar Bharat for you? What does it mean for you? What is your message that you would convey to the folks who are like really getting inspired by listening to our Prime Minister?
Yeah, see, I think people as usual, or some portions of the country as usual, get it wrong every time the Prime Minister says anything. We are talking about self-reliance and they make it out as if we should not import. I mean, you know, I think there is a difference between being self-reliant and it's not a which means that we should be in a position to control our economic future. And we should be in a position to call the shots when it comes to our economic future. That does not mean you be senseless about it and close your borders. That's not what it is. And I think it's a very good call. I think the Make in India initiative that we took transforms into this. And, you know, in India, we always get very good when it comes to a crisis situation. And this is a crisis situation. And I think the whole idea is to leverage it. So it's a great focus. I think it needs to be backed through reform, which enables this to happen very fast. Land of opportunity, but the speed at which you can capitalize on this opportunity is the question. So if that lead time to capitalize on opportunity is reduced, government doesn't have to do anything else. It's not about giving financial sobs. It's about, when they said ease of business, it is about this aspect of business. More importantly, the lead time to grab an opportunity should be much shorter. Now, I just read that Maharashtra is talking about 48-hour approvals if the investment is below this. Now, mind you, it is not that we are not the only country in the world where these problems exist. Yeah. But I'm saying that if we can meet those, then obviously we will go ahead of the others. So I think the self-reliance is a good thing. We are a country where there is a lot of youth, a lot of people are coming into the job system. We have to create jobs in order to get a good economy going and in a virtuous cycle. So anything which aids that economy is structurally changed to move ahead. And if there are more and more structural reforms to drive the rural economy, and decentralize the economic development, as it were, I think it will hold the country in good stead in the medium to long term. And I think both these things, I'm sure, are on the radar. The government knows what needs to be done. And I think as industry and as people in industry, we should support the government in this endeavor because it's good for the nation. Whichever government it is, but it's good for the nation.
Right. Interesting. And what role do you see, SMBs, small businesses in India? Do you see a massive shift happening in that field because of this whole campaign and initiative? Do you see maybe a certain level of vigilance coming in people? They're becoming a lot more serious about businesses and stuff like that. How would you foresee, say, 5 years from now? What are the things that would be a result of this whole thing?
I just get the first question, Abhinav. Just repeat it.
Sure. So what I was asking was, what is the critical, because this whole initiative is about small businesses, right, and empowering them. So what is the paradigm shift that you would see in them, say, over a period of 5 years?
I think that whether you're a small business or whether you're a large business, I think it must be a business which is up to date with the current times. And small is a question of size, but your attitude must be the same as that of a professionally run large business. And I think that shift is important. In my interaction with sometimes small businesses, they expect what I would call sort of almost like a support which is not deserved support. See, you can't say, look, I'm small, so please support me, support me, support me. I think the business that you run must be professional. The idea come in terms of helping you, but what is being scaled up has to be good. And I think businesses will realize that. And that is the philosophy that the government is using right now, that if you're a strong business, you can get a lot of assistance, which is why they're not giving out doles to everybody, because their worry is that even if you're a weak business and you get the same dole, that's not on, right? So I think the business. So when I speak to, say, small companies in food retail, and they say, okay, sir, we make this, how can we get into supermarkets? It's a standard question.
Yeah.
Then it's a margin game and a price game. But if your product is unique, then I must have to stand up and say, oh my God, I'm getting something different for my consumers, and therefore I will keep you. So it's like that, you know. So I think business models must be good quality. The product output must be unique. Then I think the small businesses have a very good chance of growing in the Indian economy.
Right, right. Interesting. So maybe we'll take a pause here, Jamshed, and I have a bunch of a rapid fire questions, like just a few, and would love to know your quick responses on all of them. Okay, what's your favorite movie?
So when I was young, I had favorite movies like McKenna's Gold. So that was a favorite movie when I was young. Then there was an era of time when I used to love the Star Wars trilogy.
Wow.
Oh yeah, I was quite a fan of Star Wars. Well, and nowadays it's Robert Downey Jr. Avenger movies, which really hold my fascination. So over time, I don't have a single favorite movie, but over time, my movie tastes, but they've always been toward movies which entertain, not too serious stuff.
Right.
Sorry, I didn't get that.
I missed the last part.
I said I don't go for too many serious movies.
Okay. Nice. And I think Star Wars is definitely a very, very common favorite here.
Yeah, and we were young at that time, so it was iconic for us. That's when the movies first came out. You must have seen the rerun.
Yeah, true. Interesting. What's your favorite song, or what all favorite
My
songs?
My favorite song is a song. Called.
Yeah. So, Jamshed, I think we missed. There was something wrong in the connection.
Yeah, I said my favorite song is a song called Proud Mary by Credence Clearwater Revival.
Okay.
Though I listen to quite a lot of music, but mostly English. I don't listen to other languages.
Right. Your favorite actor?
Well, one actor I really enjoy watching on screen is Tom Hanks.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Again, the common favorite.
I really enjoy watching him on screen. But I also enjoy character. Al Pacino. Al Pacino is another favorite of mine.
Right.
You know.
Interesting. Which all cities have you lived in, and which is your favorite one?
So I have lived in obviously Mumbai, and I have lived in Jamshedpur when I did my MBA. I lived in a place called Sangli, where I did my engineering, and I've lived in Bangalore. Well, actually, I enjoy Bombay the most. I mean, I think it's an amazing city. Enjoy the area of Mumbai. I think it's quite something. Especially the part I live in is very interesting. So,
where are you put up? South Bombay.
I stay in South Bombay, so you've got a lot of action happening here, of a different kind. But yeah, and of course. We've got the NCPA in South Bombay, which is really something which we really are privileged to have. Once again, because of the Tatas. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. I would agree to that. Yeah. Interesting. What's your favorite holiday destination in India or abroad, wherever?
Well, the family go-to destination quite clearly is Goa. And in the, okay. in Goa, we internationally, I would look at. I really enjoy going to Phuket.
Okay.
Though, as a family, we enjoy going to London. I mean, you know.
Nice.
London is a nice city. It's one of the best cities to go to with the family, I feel.
Wow, interesting. Have you been to Europe, Eurotrip, etc.? Does that excite
you? I've
been.
You know, I'm not much of a sightseeing kind of person. I enjoy the more cultural and natural surroundings of a city. But I still like London. I love London. It's very comfortable.
Got it. Which is your favorite business or a favorite company globally or in India, wherever?
Sorry, Abhinav, I didn't get the question.
Which is your favorite business or a company in India or globally, wherever?
Well, the most fun I had was at the Taj. I would still consider that my most favorite. And it's a beautiful company. I really enjoyed. And of course, Taj, all three, but you know, both in Titan and in Taj, there was a lot of fun. You know, then of course, with Star being the CEO, then but these things were real. I admire Hindustan Unilever a lot. And, you know, in the food business, we work closely with each other. So, I mean, you know, as companies, and I really admire the way they go about things and how they keep coming back and, you know, deal with the challenges that they face. And amongst business groups, other than, of course, the Tatas, I really admire the Mahindra Group. I think they are very... about it. Okay. People focused a very, very nice, very good culture. I really admire them for what they do.
True, true, absolutely. And I think Anand himself has been like a biggest inspiration for the country. So, indeed. Interesting. And since we're talking about Taj, I think when 2611 happened, you were there, right? And you were one of the CXOs there, right? So what was the pulse like? How scared were people? What were your key learnings when a thing like that happens?
See, I think people obviously were concerned. And, you know, we have many hotels in the city. So while the attack happened on one hotel, we had staff working in all the other hotels. And all the hotels were very vulnerable.
Yeah.
Looking out, so President was one of them. We were very vulnerable, but there was no fear. There was concern, but there was no fear. And of course, there was because many of our colleagues were trapped, etc., etc., and our customers were trapped. But we knew very clear and be courageous because of two things. One is it was a very dastardly act. See, if there's a natural disaster, it's one thing. But when an act like this happens, your strength and resolve actually goes up, doesn't come down. And we were very clear that we had to overcome this challenge. I think the was brilliantly done. I mean, we all got together and we all made sure that we were all informed and on top of it. Quick decisions were taken when they needed to be taken. And we had the leadership team made sure that it was not only we were focusing on this, we were also making sure that all the other hotels are getting secure and safe because we had a much larger responsibility and nobody knew. See, at that time, in retrospect, we knew what happened, but nobody knew at that time. Is this the only attack? Are the other hotels going to be under pressure? What about other cities? Are they going to be attacked? Nobody knew, right? And I think in the Tata Group, the leadership is always together. I mean, you know, they're all, and this front that we had, which really saw the day, along with, of course, the courage of all the people who were actually on site, be it in the Taj or in other hotels also, you know, because they came by sea. I mean, they could have easily come by sea to Goa, I mean, you know, Cochin, and we have hotels all over the place.
Yeah, true. Absolutely.
Beyond that, I think one quick final question on the fireside chat, and then we can get back to the general bunch of questions that we have. We could probably take a few from audience as well. Is which are the successful people you follow? Like whenever you're down, like how do you kind of bring yourself back up, or like the people who really motivate you?
Well, actually, more than there are many people who obviously motivate. But more, you know, there is that story, apocryphal story, which people must have heard about the king wanting one statement, which describes good and bad and storm and, you know, pleasant. And one of his ministers comes and says, "This too shall pass." And that's the philosophy I use whenever there is a low moment, and there are many low moments in one's life. By saying that this too shall pass. And that means you get an opportunity to look ahead. Every day is a new day and a different day. And as a leader, the job is to face the ups and the downs. But when you're down, you have to look up. And when you're up, you have to make sure that you take care of things so that when you go down, you're ready to come back up again. And I think it's basically in times of crisis or any such situation, you have to take it by the day. I found that to be very useful. If you take it a day at a time, very often we do a lot of mind talk as to what may happen, ifs and buts, etc., etc. It's good.
Dinesh, I think we lost completely what you said last. So if you can repeat, maybe.
No, I said that if you stick to the philosophy of this too shall pass, it can really be useful in times of crisis.
Absolutely. Got it. Interesting. Any big turning point in your life? Yeah, we got that. Thanks. The next question I would love to know from you is any big turning point in your life, and then say things were just not adding up at all, but suddenly you did something and it was all back to normal, or whatever you're trying to achieve just happened?
Well, none of that. I think certainly in my life, the various turning points that I've had in my life are when I, in my professional life, is when I've taken the plunge to move from one industry to another. These have all been turning points, you know, because
I think we have lost Dimshing.
All these have been turning points. Give me a second.
No, I'm so sorry.
Just give me.
I think you just blacked out.
Just give me a minute. Yeah. Just a minute.
Sure.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, much better.
Okay, and I'll just move to another hotspot. But yeah, keep going. Just ask me the question.
Sure. Okay. The next one is, what is your style of leadership? And specifically, when you say find young leaders, right? How do you kind of get them to understand? And obviously, experience plays a very critical role, right? So when you have young leaders, how do you kind of make sure that they catch up and learn the importance of experience and things like that, and your overall style of leadership in general?
So my overall style of leadership is that I have a very hierarchy-free leadership style. I mean, I personally believe that the whole idea of leadership is to move the company forward and not to keep managing hierarchy and ego and all that sort of stuff. So my leadership style is extremely direct. What you see is what you get. I mean, I have interactions with everybody. I don't sort of pull punches. On the other hand, I encourage young leaders and young leadership. I personally believe that experience is a double-edged sword. Sometimes it can give you and sometimes when you are young and some you are not burdened by experience also. I do recognize that young people are not necessarily burdened by experience, and because of that, it's important that we encourage young leaders as much as we encourage experienced leaders. So it's a bit of both, and so I find that that bring is important for keeping the organization going. And my way of encouraging, can you hear me?
Yeah, please go ahead.
My way of encouraging young leaders is by giving them challenges which are far ahead of their capability. I personally believe you have to challenge them far ahead of their capability, and they will respond. And even if they don't respond fully, you have to be there to catch them in case they don't respond fully. That's the best form of accelerated leadership. You can keep sending them for training programs and all, that's fine. But if you don't challenge them adequately and move them ahead, you're never going to get leaders fast enough. So, but I young leaders, I think it's integrating and you learn
right,
a lot.
Right, absolutely. So I think, Damshit, there's a quick question from Sanjana on the chat. I'll read it for you and you can let us know your thoughts. She's asking, what would you say has the impact been, and how long will it go for consumer facing products due to COVID?
Yeah, it depends on the industry. I think that, like I said, food will obviously, and therefore food products will obviously bounce back very fast. I think the guys who are going to have the apparel people, I think on the consumer facing companies, apparel and hospitality and hotels, restaurants, etc., etc. And I think any business which is not only essential, but where the trust factor required is very high. So if you go to a restaurant, it's not about how far the next table is. It's about what's happening in the kitchen. You understand what I mean? That's where you need
Absolutely.
The trust factor.
Yeah.
item is not where the trust factor is non-essential will take a long time to get back. Wherever either the trust factor required is not very high or the item is very essential, I think the time will be much shorter. And that's how it'll go. And, you know, you have to come up with creative solutions to the quality in industries like in apparel will be quite challenged, I think, you know. And they have to, I don't think there is any easy solution there. You can go online, offline, whatever, but it's not going to be easy. I'm about physical. Online is a different game altogether.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with you 100% on that. Cool. I think, Jamshed, just short of time, just one final thing where we would love to end this is what are your three key learnings in life and the glorious like 34 years experience that you have? Like, if you had to summarize in three key learnings, what would they be?
See, from a business point of view, can you hear me?
Yes, please.
Hello.
Yes, Jamshed.
From a business point of view, I think the first learning is always look at your business outside in as much as you look at it inside out. Okay, I try to wear the customer lens almost all the time. That's the first learning. The second learning is you're nobody without your people.
So sorry if you can please repeat. I think there was a complete blackout on the internet side.
Now can you hear me?
Yes.
Hello. So the first learning is that to look at the business from outside in, which means from the eyes of the customer. The second learning is you're nowhere without your people.
Yeah, true.
And the third is a core set of values and individuals which you must stand for. Okay, and these are not only values about integrity, honesty, and all that's a given. But like in my case, my value was that what you see is what you get. I mean, this is me and I will come through to you straight, good or bad, but that's what it is. No, and I stand by that. You know what I mean? And these are the three core that's me.
Right. Cool. I think that brings us to the end of this episode. I thank you like a lot, Jamshed. Thanks a lot for taking time and talking to us. I think we can go on for hours and 1 hour. 1 hour is not even a justice to the kind of questions and the time we would need to learn from you. So thanks a lot for taking time. It's been an absolute pleasure hosting you here. And let's keep in touch. Would love to kind of circle back again sometime again in future. And as things
and thanks there. To all the participants who sat through.
Cool. Thanks everyone. This episode is available on the Facebook page of Profile as well. Because we're next streaming there. So.
Lovely.
Cool. Thanks a lot everyone for joining. Have a great day ahead. Thank you. Thanks, Jamshed. Bye-bye.